Hello students, in today's lecture we will be discussing about the placenta. This is Dr. Yusuf signing from Aljof University. For today's topic, the specific objective is describe the mature placenta and mention its functions as well as anomalies. So we will be discussing about the mature placenta, its functions as well as anomalies. But apart from the mature placenta, we will also study some of the development of the placenta also. So the placenta is described as an organ that helps in the nutrition as well as the gaseous exchange between the fetus as well as the mother. So this is a very important organ which helps in the exchange of nutrition as well as the gas, the oxygen as well as the carbon dioxide required for the development of the fetus. So this placenta has two surfaces. One is the fetal surface, which is smooth, and the second surface is rough, which is called as maternal surface. If you can see here in this picture, this is the picture of the placenta. So this is the smooth surface of the fetal surface of the placenta, and this is the maternal surface, which is rough in nature. So in this picture, if you see, this is the fetus within the womb of the mother. And here you can see this is the placenta. This whole thing is the placenta. It has two surfaces. The surface which is facing towards the fetus, this is called as fetal surface, and it is smooth. And the other surface which is towards the mother, this is called as maternal surface, and this is adherent to the womb or the uterus of the mother. Okay, so this surface is rough when you reflect it, and this is called as the maternal surface. So there are two surfaces for the placenta. Placenta is a discoid shape structure or organ with a smooth surface, which is called as fetal surface. This surface is smooth because it is covered by amnion. So if you can see here, there is the amnion covering the smooth surface. So because of this amnion covering it, this becomes smooth, and it has been partly reflected so that you can see the when the amnion is reflected, how exactly the placenta look like. And this it can also be identified. One is by the smooth surface, and the second is the attachment of the umbilical cord. If you can see here, this is the fetal surface, which is smooth and covered by the amnion, and you can also see the attachment of the placenta on the fetal surface. The maternal surface is rough and irregular. If you can see here, so this surface is rough and irregular because of some elevations. These are called as cotyledons. These are called as cotyledons, and these are around 15 to 30 in number, and they are limited by some depression. These are called as fissures. Around them there is a depression. These are the fissures which separate one cotyledon from the other. So these elevated structures are called as cotyledon. These are the functional units which we will discuss later. In case of mature placenta, the size is almost 15 to 25 centimeters in total diameter from one side to the other side. It will be almost 15 to 25 centimeters in diameter, and the thickness is at the thickest at the center, and it is almost 3 centimeters. Can see here, as you go towards the periphery it becomes thinner, and at the center it is thickest, and this is almost 3 centimeters in thickness. So the total diameter from one side to the other side will be almost 15 to 25 centimeters, and the thickness which is maximum at the center will be almost 3 centimeters, and the weight of this placenta is almost half a kilo or 500 grams in a mature placenta. And if you see the surface area, even though it looks a smaller structure or organ, but if you spread it, it becomes almost 14 square meters. This is almost equal to the surface of the intestine, or it is also equal to the size of the if you spread the lung, the total surface area, which is helpful for the exchange of gases, will be almost 14 square meters. So this surface area of the placenta is also almost 14 square meters, which is equal to that of the gut or the respiratory system. If you see the placenta, usually the normal site of attachment of this placenta in case of the uterus will be almost towards the fundus of the uterus. So if you can see in this picture, so here this is the fundus and it is almost towards the fundus and mostly on the posterior wall, mostly on the posterior wall. So it is normal site of attachment of the placenta will be near the fundus and usually on the posterior wall of the fundus of the uterus. Okay, so this is the normal side. But subsequently, as there are multiple pregnancies, the site will keep on descending with every pregnancy. Coming to the functions of the placenta, so the first function is, as we have already seen, that it is the exchange of metabolic as well as the gaseous products between the maternal as well as the fetal blood streams. So there will be exchange of oxygen, that is continuous supply of the oxygen by almost 25 ml per minute, and almost the same quantity of carbon dioxide is removed from the fetal blood. So all the there will be continuous non-stop supply of the oxygen through this placenta, which is very helpful for the development of the fetus. The second is exchange of nutrients. So as the fetus is not feeding orally, so it has to be supplied with nutrition, continuous supply of nutrition through the blood in the form of carbohydrate, lipids, polypeptides, amino acids, as well as vitamins, as well as the electrolytes, all are supplied from the maternal blood into the fetal blood. The third is transmission of ready-made maternal antibodies so that the fetus doesn't get affected with any kind of infections or something like that by some of the antibodies like IgG, immunoglobulin. So everything will be supplied ready-madely, because even now still the fetus doesn't have the capacity to produce its own antibodies and fight the bacteria or any viral infections. So there will be transmission of ready-made maternal antibodies into the fetus. Some of the other functions, like the production of hormones, the placenta has the capacity to produce lot of hormones like the progesterone, estrogen, mainly the estriol, then relaxin, placental lactogen, as well as HCG, all which are very important for the development of the fetus as well as the maintenance of the pregnancy. It also acts as the a very important excretory organ and removes the waste products like the urea, carbon dioxide and other waste products. And this placenta also acts as a very important barrier which prevents any kind of transmission of bacteria, viruses from the mother to the fetus through a barrier called as placental barrier. So the placental membrane protect the fetus as the maternal and fetal blood don't mix. This is a very important concept, where even though the blood of the maternal and the fetal blood will come very close to each other, they don't mix. So this is very important in preventing the antigenic reaction, especially if there is Rh factor positive and negative. Okay, so this acts as a very important protective barrier. So these are some of the functions of the placenta. Now we'll go back and see what are the functions it is doing. One is, it is helping in the exchange of gases. So it is acting like a respiratory organ like the lungs. Okay, it is giving continuous supply of the nutrition to the developing fetus. So a lot of metabolism is also taking place within the placenta. It also acts as a what you can say as the a very important immune defense mechanism by transmitting the maternal antibodies, ready-made antibodies, into the fetus. So it is also acting as a endocrine organ by producing so many hormones. It also acts as an excretory organ by removing all the waste products like the urea, carbon dioxide and other waste products. It also acts as a barrier which prevents the lot of infections as well as even the mixing of the maternal fetal blood. So it has multiple roles. It acts as a lung, it acts as a reproductive, what you can say, the metabolic organ. It also acts as a immune defense mechanism. It also acts as an endocrine organ. It also acts as excretory organ, and it also acts as a protective organ. Okay, so it has multiple roles. So the functions of the placenta are many. Even though it is a single small organ, but it acts as it has multiple roles by which it will be doing multiple roles and giving continuous required materials for the fetus. So we discussed that there is a barrier between the maternal and fetal blood, which is called as the placental barrier, or this is also called as placental membrane. So we'll look into what is this barrier exactly, how it is formed. So this barrier is formed by four layers or four structures. The first is the endothelium of the fetal blood vessels and its basement membrane. If you can see the villi which are within the placenta, we'll go into the villi, the different types of villi, but if you take a section of the villi, this is how it looks like. Here will be the maternal blood, and deep inside here will be the capillaries where the fetal blood will be present. And in between we have four layers, starting from outside to inside, or from inside to outside. As mentioned here, one is the endothelium of the fetal blood vessels. So here are the fetal blood vessels, and these fetal blood vessels are lined by a very thin cells, which are the endothelium of the fetal blood vessels, with a small nuclei here. They are very thin cells, which acts as the first barrier. The second barrier is extra embryonic mesoderm. Around this blood vessels, there is the extra embryonic mesoderm, which is nothing but the connective tissue layer. The third is the cytotrophoblasts, which are around this. Here are the cytotrophoblastic cells and its basement membrane, so which acts as the third barrier. And the fourth barrier is the scintigotrophoblast cells. So scintigotrophoblast, you can identify the cytotrophoblasts have definite cell membrane as well as the nucleus. In case of scintigotrophoblast, the cell membrane is not seen, so it looks like as though this cell layer has multiple nuclei. Okay, so that's what is called as scintigo. Scintigo means joining together. So in case of scintigotrophoblast, the cell membrane is not properly seen, and you can see multiple nuclei here. So these are the four layers which acts as the placental barrier, and outside here will be the this will be the intravillar space where you can see the maternal blood, and deep inside here will the fetal blood which will be flowing. And whenever there is exchange of material, it has to pass through by diffusion through these four layers. The first layer is the endothelium of the blood vessel. The second is the extra embryonic mesoderm. The third is the cytotrophoblastic cells as well as its basement membrane. And the fourth is the scintigotrophoblastic cells. Okay, so these are the four layers which acts as the placental barrier. So here you can see a much more enlarged picture where you can see the maternal blood capillaries, the fetal blood capillaries, where it is lined by the endothelium, and here there are multiple blood vessels, and here is the connective tissue layer, and the third is the cytotrophoblast cells with the basement membrane, and around it will be the scintigotrophoblastic layer. Okay, so these are the four layers which acts as the placental barrier. This placental barrier, as I said before, it is almost 4 to 14 square meters in surface area. If you spread this all the villi on a plane surface, this becomes almost 4 to 14 square meters, which is equal to the total absorptive area of the adult intestine. So it is almost equal to that of the absorptive area within the adult intestinal tract. Okay, so this is about the placental barrier with the four membranes. The substances that crosses this placental barrier are very few and still present. Even though there is a barrier, but some of the substances can pass through this placental barrier. So what are the a substance which can pass through this barrier. The first is some of the organisms, some viruses like the virus of the poliomyelitis, the AIDS virus, the measles as well as the rubella virus. And some of the bacteria can also pass through this placental membrane. And there are some drugs which can pass through this barrier and it can cause lot of effects, like previously they used to use a drug called as thalidomide, which led pass through the placental barrier and it caused some kind of very abnormal defect which led to the newborns with short limbs, the upper limb and the lower limb. If you can see this picture, this is how the effect of thalidomide caused in the newborns with short limbs, upper limb and lower limb. Thalidomide was a drug which used to be given for the early morning sickness of in the early stages of the pregnancy, and that led to a very severe side effect with short limbs. Where born, they had short limbs, so later this drug was banned. So this some of the drugs can also pass through the placental barrier. That's why always try to avoid any kind of drug, especially during pregnancy, unless it is recommended, and then we have to check whether it is safe to give, and only if it is recommended. If not, just we have to avoid any kind of drugs in case of the pregnancy. So some of the organism like virus and some of the bacteria can pass through, some of the drugs can also pass through it, and sometimes even some of the chemicals, very dangerous effects might have through some of the chemicals like insecticides which are sprayed on the vegetables which are grown, as well as the fruits and other things. So it has to be treated before we give it to the pregnant lady. So some of the chemicals like insecticides can also pass through the placental barrier and they can cause severe damage to the fetus. But there are advantages also because of the passing of the structures through the barrier, like some of the substances like the maternal antibodies which are helpful, like the IgG immunoglobulins also pass through the barrier, but they are helpful. But most of the substances which I told before are dangerous, but there can be some of the structures, substances which might be useful when they pass through. There can be also the rhesus factor. Rhesus factor is the factor which is indicated as positive or negative along with your blood group. Okay, so this rhesus factor might be positive or effective, negative, and this is very important, especially if the mother is Rh negative and the baby or the fetus is Rh positive, and this might create big damage to the subsequent pregnancies. The mother produces the anti-Rh antibodies which causes hemolysis of the fetal blood cells in case of the future pregnancies. Okay, so in case of the mother being Rh negative and the fetus being Rh positive, usually the blood doesn't mix, as we have seen that there is a barrier, and usually the maternal blood and the fetal blood are separated by the four layers. But during delivery, when during the separation of the placenta, the at the later stages during the separation, there might be few droplets of the maternal blood which can pass through the barrier during the separation of the placenta, and it might pass into the mother. Or if there is any damage even to the barrier itself, sometimes there might be some kind of mixing with the fetal blood with the mother, and the maternal blood produces whenever there is contact of the Rh positive factor with the maternal blood. There might be production of the anti-Rh antibodies in the mother, and in case of future pregnancies, it doesn't affect the first pregnancy, but in case of future pregnancy, again if she have she has Rh positive fetus, at that time it can cause severe damage during the development of the fetus itself, and even it might lead to the death of the fetus itself. So this is also a very important thing which you are supposed to remember. So this is about the placental barrier and substances which can pass through this barrier. So some of the organisms, as I said, bacteria, some viruses can also pass through this, some of the drugs can pass through this, and some of the chemicals can also pass through this. So that's why the pregnant lady should be very careful before she takes anything. Now coming to the umbilical cord. So this umbilical cord, which is the connection between, the only connection between the fetus and the mother, is by some of the structures which are there within the umbilical cord. If you can see here, this is the placenta and this is the umbilical cord. This umbilical cord will have two umbilical arteries. If you can see here in this picture, you can see the two umbilical arteries. So even though we are telling it is arteries, it is shown in blue color because these arteries will be carrying deoxygenated blood from the fetus to the mother. So if it is carrying deoxygenated blood, why it is called as arteries? Because these are the arteries which are pumping blood away from the heart of the fetus. So that's why it is called as arteries. But because the lungs are still not functioning, so it will be calling carrying the deoxygenated blood. In the later stages after the birth, these umbilical arteries remain as remnants, and these are called as median umbilical ligament. In the later stages after development, these will disappear and they remain as remnants. And this umbilical cord also consists of one umbilical vein. Even though we call it as vein, it is shown in red color because it will be carrying oxygenated blood from the mother into the fetus. So this will be the umbilical vein, okay, which will be carrying the oxygenated blood. Okay, so this in the later stages after birth, this remains as a remnant, and this will be called as the ligamentum teres. Okay, the third structure which will be present within this umbilical cord is the presence of a thick jelly like material, thick pad of fat or jelly like material, which is called as Wharton's jelly. This is to prevent any damage or compression to these arteries and the veins, because the fetus will be twisting and turning within the womb, and even slight compression of this vessels might lead to decrease in blood supply, oxygenated blood supply and nutrition to the fetus, and that might lead to there will be a growth retardation. To prevent that, there is a thick pad of fat or jelly like material. This is called as Wharton's jelly, which will prevent kinking and compression of these blood vessels which are deep inside. The distal part of the allantoid diverticulum can also be traced, and this is called, later it becomes the uracus. And the vitelo-intestinal duct, a small duct which will be remain later in later stages as the Meckel's diverticulum, also will be a part of this umbilical cord. So the main contents of this umbilical cord are two umbilical arteries, one umbilical vein, as well as the Wharton's jelly. Along with that, sometimes we can also trace a distal part of the allantoid diverticulum as well as the vitelo-intestinal duct. Okay. Coming to the anomalies. So there can be many types of anomalies. One very common anomaly which we see usually in some of the pregnancies is called as the placenta previa. Usually, as we have discussed before, the placenta will be attached to the uterus near the fundus of the uterus, and usually in the posterior wall or sometimes in the anterior wall. So this will be the normal position of the placenta, and the fetus will be below. in the placenta previa, it will be just opposite. You can see here the placenta previa. In placenta previa, you can see the placenta near the cervix. So near the opening of the cervix. So this is called as the placenta previa. Okay. So this is of different types. So it can be divided into degrees, like first degree, second degree, third degree, and fourth degree, or it can also it is classified as centralis, marginalis, and lateralis. Okay, in case of centralis, this is the fourth degree stage, where you can see the placenta is totally covering the opening of the cervix, and this is the most dangerous one and difficult one to deliver, because during delivery, the placenta is the first structure which will be coming out, and this will be blocking the delivery of the fetus itself. Okay, so it will be blocking and it makes the delivery difficult, as well as actually it is supposed to come at the last. Okay, but this will be the first structure. If there is any delivery through this route, through the cervix, then it will be the placenta itself. So if the first structure to be detached will be the placenta and the fetus is still inside, then it might lead to at least a small break in the supply of the nutrition as well as the oxygen which is needed till it comes out from the uterus. So this can really damage the fetus itself, because for a short duration there might be no oxygen supply as well as no supply of the nutrition, especially the oxygen supply, which is even for a short duration which is stopped because the placenta is coming out first and the fetus is still inside and it is not respiring. So it can really damage the brain itself. Okay. So this is the fourth stage, but in case of the first degree and second degree, you can see here the placenta is there near the cervix, but it is not covering the cervix, it is away from the cervix. So in the second degree, it has come to the margin of the cervix, but still it is not covering. In the third stage, it is covering the cervix, but whenever there is dilatation of the cervix, then this placenta will be pulled upwards itself. So there might not be much blockage in the delivery, but still it can impact the delivery, but still it can open up. But in the fourth stage, it is totally covering itself in the opening, so there cannot be delivery so easily, or with difficulty there might be difficulty with the delivery of the fetus. So in the case of first degree, the placenta is away from the opening of the cervix. In the second degree, it is coming towards the margin. In case of the third degree, it is covering the cervix. In case of second degree, it is not covering, it is up to the margin itself. The third degree, it is covering, but still whenever there is dilatation of the cervix, it will open up itself. But in case of fourth degree, it is totally covering the opening of the cervix itself. So this is also divided to centralis, where it is totally covering, or marginalis, where it is towards the margins. Okay, in the first degree and second degree. In case of lateralis, near the second degree and third degree, where it is marginalis, and in case of the first degree, it is lateralis. So these are some of the plaza conditions where the placenta previa is divided into degrees, or the type centralis, marginalis, and lateralis. The other anomalies of the placenta are like battle doe placenta, where the cord is inserted at the periphery. Usually the placenta, in case of normal placenta, the umbilical cord will be at the center, almost at the center. But in case of battle doe placenta, the cord is inserted at the periphery of the placenta itself. You can see here it is at the periphery. So this is called the battle doe placenta. Okay, sometimes it might be is a single umbilical cord which is dividing into multiple branches, and then it is supplying. And sometimes it is in the form of remnants. It is not very clearly as a umbilical cord. Okay, so these are some of the different kinds of battle doe placenta, where the placenta is not the umbilical cord is not at the center, but at the periphery, at the margins. Then there can be accessory placenta. Usually the placenta is one, usually, but sometimes there might be more than one placenta. Like here in this care condition, there are two placenta of equal size. This is called as the bidiscoidal. Bi means two, so it is two disc-like. So that's why it is called as bidiscoidal. So there is umbilical cord here. It is dividing into two equal halves, and then it is supplying each of the placenta. Okay. So these this condition is called a bidiscoidal, where there are two placentas. Then sometimes it can be lobed. There is a single placenta, but it has multiple lobes, and this umbilical cord is dividing itself into a branch for each lobe. Okay, so this is called as lobed placenta. Sometimes the placenta doesn't have shape, it is just diffuse. Like here in this condition, you can see there is no regular shape. Usually, as I said, the placenta will be disc-like around. Okay, but here it is very diffuse. There is no exact structure. It is just spreading on the uterus itself. So this is called as diffuse type. Sometimes there can be a condition where it is called as the placenta accentuaria, where we have an regular placenta, but along with that there is an accessory structure of the placenta which is away from it. So this is the fourth type. Then sometimes the placenta might be fenestrated. There might be a hole, an opening, or a deficiency within the placenta. This is called as the fenestrated type of the placenta. Okay. And sometimes there can be a condition where the placenta is reflecting the decidua basalis itself, decidua of the uterus, and it reflects and it is directly adhering to the muscular wall. There are three walls. If you remember, the placenta has three walls. One is the innermost mucous structure is called as the decidua, okay, which sheds, okay. And this is reflected, and the second layer is muscular. It is going and getting adherent to the muscular wall itself. So in this condition, the during delivery, the placenta has to be reflected and it has to be thrown out. But here in this condition, it is very difficult to separate this kind of placenta because it is totally adhering to the muscular wall. Okay, so this is called as the myometrium, the muscular wall of the it has three layers, as you can remember, the endometrium, the myometrium, as well as the perimetrium. The perimetrium is the more outermost, which is nothing but the thin layer of the thin layer of the peritoneum. Okay, so the outermost will be the peritoneum. And here this placenta is totally adhering to the myometrium, and separating this kind of placenta becomes very difficult, especially during delivery. So this is called a circumvallate, where the endometrium has been reflected, which is the decidual part, and it is going and getting adherent to the myometrium. Okay, so these are some of the different types of placenta, accessory placenta. The first one is bidiscoidal, the second is the diffuse, the third is the second is the lobed, the third is the diffuse one, then we have the placenta accentuaria, then fifth is the fenestrated, and the sixth is the circumvallate. One more important thing we should know at this level is something called the surrogate mother. This is nowadays it is becoming very popular, and this is in vitro fertilization of the oocyte of the female with the husband's sperm. Okay, so this is in vitro, it's not in vivo. So the sperms of the husband are taken out, as well as the oocyte of the female, the mother, and they are fertilized outside in the chemical laboratory, and then it will be the fertilized egg will be transferred back into the mother or to another female, where she will be maintaining the pregnancy till the 9 month, and then she will deliver. So this condition is called as surrogate mother, where the the egg from the mother will be taken out, and the sperm from the father will be fertilized in a lab, and the fertilized egg will be transferred to a third woman where she will be maintaining the pregnancy. In case of some of the conditions where the mother, actual mother, cannot maintain her pregnancy because of some of the abnormalities within the uterus, so a third lady will take the responsibility, and that fertilized egg will be transferred into that lady, and she will maintain the pregnancy for 9 months, and then she would deliver. So this condition is called as surrogate mother. Now coming to the development of the placenta itself, we have seen the mature placenta, its functions as well as its anomalies. Now we'll discuss some of the development of the placenta itself. Okay. So if you recall back, we have studied the first week of development, second week of development, as well as the third week of development after gestation. So during those development, we have seen the transformation of the trophoblastic cells. So we have seen there are two layers of the trophoblastic cells, the syncytiotrophoblast as well as the cytotrophoblast. So the syncytiotrophoblast sends finger-like projections, which are called as villi. So in this, the later pictures, we'll discuss this, how the in this pictures we will show you. Okay, here you can see here, this is during the late stage of the first week, where we have seen that these are the cytotrophoblasts which have been differentiated, these are the trophoblast cells which are differentiated into cytotrophoblastic cells as well as the syncytiotrophoblast, and these syncytiotrophoblasts will be, after implantation, these syncytiotrophoblasts have the capacity to erode the endometrium, and they give finger-like projections, and these will start eroding the endometrium as well as the blood vessels of the endometrium. If you can see here, so this becomes the villi-like structure. These are called as primary villi, and in between there will be some space. This is called as the intravillar space. Later, when they start eroding even the blood vessel, the blood of the maternal blood will come, and it will be start flowing within the intravillar space. So this is called, space is called intravillus, because between the two villi, this is the space between the two villi, so it is called intravillar space, and this intravillar space will be filled with the maternal blood, and here these are called as villi. So these villi are coming from the initially from the syncytiotrophoblast. So we have seen that the trophoblast as cytotrophoblast as well as syncytiotrophoblast. These are the cytotrophoblast and the syncytiotrophoblast, and the syncytiotrophoblast send finger-like projections or villi. So they are sending, initially it will be just a thick plate, later it sends finger-like projection. These are called as villi, even though they are in the primary stage, that invade the endometrium. So they are invading the endometrium, or it is also called as a deciduum, this part where there is implantation. So that part of the endometrium is called a deciduum. So these villi erode the decidual blood vessels, forming lacunae in intervillar space filled with maternal blood. So these spaces become smaller spaces, which are called a lacunae, which join together to form a larger space called an intervillar space, and they erode the blood vessels, and the blood vessels start flowing into this intervillar space. Okay. At day 12 of the syncytiotrophoblast penetrate more deeply, the lacunae became continuous with the maternal blood, as you have seen already, with the maternal sinusoids. So you can see here the maternal sinusoids are opening into the intervillar space. So the maternal blood enters the lacunar system. Now this is called as uteroplacental circulation. So with the maternal blood entering into this intervillar space, now it is called as uteroplacental circulation. Still the fetus is here. Okay, so initially it will be two layered, and then later it becomes gestation stage where there will be three layers, ectoderm, endoderm, and in between in the mesoderm. So still it is in the form of a plate, but there is no connection between the maternal blood and the fetal blood is still here. So it has still have to diffuse all the way up to here to supply its nutrition into the fetus. So this is called as uteroplacental circulation. So this uteroplacental circulation begins by the appearance of the extra embryonic mesoderm. The wall of the chorionic vesicle is called as the chorion. So if you can see in this picture, so this part, this is called as the, with the appearance of the extra embryonic mesoderm. This is the extra embryonic mesoderm which has appeared. Initially there is no extra embryonic mesoderm. Later there will be appearance of the extra embryonic mesoderm which form the two layers. And with the appearance of extra embryonic mesoderm, the three structures, the syncytiotrophoblast, the cytotrophoblast, as well as the extra embryonic mesoderm, this together, these are called as the chorion. Chorion. So chorion means syncytiotrophoblast plus cytotrophoblast, but the plus the outer layer of the extra embryonic mesoderm, which together this is called as the chorionic plate. So this whole thing is called as the chorionic plate. Syncytiotrophoblast, cytotrophoblast, as well as the extra embryonic mesoderm, together all this will be called the chorion or the chorionic plate. Now so if you can see here, this is the fetus, and here we can see the development of the placenta. Okay, the changes in the trophoblast. By the beginning of the second month, the trophoblast is characterized by a great number of second as well as the third degree villi that give it a radial appearance. If you can see here, so here in this stage it is still growing, okay, and the villi, so these are called as the primary villi. Initially it will be only the syncytiotrophoblast. Now later we can see even the cytotrophoblast as well as the extra embryonic mesoderm entering it. Okay, so in the second month it will be in the secondary villi as well as the tertiary villi will start appearing. And you can see here, this is the fetus, and these villi will later get their definite shape. Initially they will be just villi like structures, later they look like start branching and they look like tree. Okay. Now we have to know two important terms at this stage. One is called as the chorionic plate. So here we can see here, this is the chorionic plate. Okay, what is this chorionic plate? Extra embryonic mesoderm lining inside of the cytotrophoblast that border the placenta from the fetal side. If you can see here, so this is the fetus, so that this is the border which faces the fetal side. So this forms the chorionic plate, which is nothing but the extra embryonic mesoderm lining the cytotrophoblastic cells. So this is the extra embryonic mesoderm which along with the cytotrophoblast, this form the chorionic plate. There is other plate here, this is called a decidual plate. On the other side we have, this is called as the decidual plate. What is this decidual plate? It is nothing but the testudia basalis border the placenta from the maternal side. So it is bordering the placenta from the maternus. So here is the endometrium. So this is the decidua. So this part, this is for part which covers which borders the placenta from the maternal side, this is called as the decidual plate. It forms a plate around, this is called as the decidual plate. So there are two plates here now. One is the chorionic plate, and on the other side it will be the decidual plate. The chorionic plate is towards the maternal side, and the decidual plate will be towards the maternal side. The outer cytotrophoblast shells attach the villi to the maternal decidua. Now this, in between these two will be the villi. So this chorionic plate is connected by the decidual plate by the presence of these villi like structures. These are extending from the fetal side to the maternal side. The outer cytotrophoblast shell attach the villi. So these are the villi which are attaching the chorionic plate towards the decidual plate. Okay. Lacuna or intermedial space in between will be seen. Okay. So in between, so between the villi there can be larger spaces, which are initially they will be called as lacunae, smaller spaces. Later these will lacunae will join together to form a larger space. These are called an intravillar space because they are between the villi. So these are called an intravillar space. Now this intravillar space will be filled with the maternal blood, with the eroding of the sinusoids of the maternal side. So these blood vessels start opening into this. So you can see here, these are the spiral arteries opening into the intervillous space. Okay, so that is about the chorionic plate as well as decidual plate and the intervillous space, and these are the villi. Now we have to know some of the other terms here. Something called as we have said that chorion. So the chorion are of three types. One, we can, the first one is called as chorionic fundosum, bushy or villous chorion, which is well developed villi on the embryonic pole. If you can see here in this picture, so here we have chorionic fundosum. So chorionic fundosum, bushy or villous chorion, well developed villi on the embryonic pole. So you can imagine this in a much more clearly in this picture. If you take a section at this level like this, and then see, this is the wall of the uterus, and here you can see here is the fetus, deep inside is the fetus, which is deep inside, and here you can see the chorionic plate, and the decidual plate is on the other side, and you can see these are the villi. So these are the villi. Okay, initially if you see here, the villi are on all the sides, villi are all on the sides. In the later stages, if you can see, they will be present in all the sides. Okay, in the later stages, all these villi will be disappearing. They will disappear in all these sides except at this part where the villi are present, and they are in the bushy form, and they are towards the decidua basalis. This part is called the chorionic fundosum. This is called as chorionic fundosum. Here if you can see here, chorionic fundosum, here they have disappeared. The area where these villi have disappeared, this is called the chorionic leave. So because they are leaving, so this is called as chorionic leave, where they are disappearing. Okay, so here they have disappeared. If you remember, the decidua are of three types, where the fetus is attached, this part of the decidua. As I said, decidua are nothing but the endometrium, which is well grown and which is highly nutritious, and it will be supplying the nutrition to the developing fetus in the initial stages. Okay, so this decidua is on all the side, but where it is in contact with the fetus, this part is called a decidua basalis. The other part where it lines on the other side, this is called as the decidua capsula parietalis. This is the decidua parietalis. A part, small part of the decidua also covers here the fetus. This is called as the decidua capsularis. So the decidua are of three types. Where it is attached, that is called as decidua basalis. A part of the decidua covers the fetus, this is called as the decidua capsulis in the form of capsule, and the remaining part of the decidua endometrium, this is called as the decidua parietalis. So in this condition, in case of the chorionic fundosum, the villi will be present only in the decidua basalis. They have disappeared in the decidua capsulis. This is the decidua capsularis, and here is the villi there. So later these villi disappear at the decidua capsularis. This place, this area is called as the chorionic leave, because they have left the chorion. So chorionic leave, it will be smooth chorion, villi on the embryonic pole. So the villi have totally disappeared at this pole here. Okay, so now all the villi are present only on the chorionic fundosum, which is toward the decidua basalis. This is the decidua basalis, and you can see the chorionic fundosum, the villi present only at this decidua basalis. Later this will grow into the mature placenta, this part where we have the decidua basalis as well as the chorionic fundosum is present. This will later develop into the mature placenta. As we have discussed, decidua basalis is that part where the fetus is embedded. Okay, and this is where we can see the chorionic fundosum. The decidua capsularis is a thin layer of the endometrium which covers the fetus on the embryonic pole. This is the embryonic pole, this is the embryonic pole. We are discovering the embryonic pole. This is called the decidua capsularis. The remaining part of the endometrium of the uterus is called as the decidua parietalis. Now, a very important stage will appear as the fetus starts growing. If you can see here, this fetus is totally covered by the amniotic cavity. If you remember the development of the fetus during first year, first week, second week and third week, then you can see how the amniotic cavity totally covers. Initially, only it will be on the ventral side of the fetus, but later it covers the whole of the amniotic cavity. For that, you have to go back to the development of the fetus during the first, second and third week. Okay, so now it is the amnion is totally covering the fetus, and outside here we have the chorionic cavity. Okay, outside the amniotic cavity we have the chorionic cavity, deep inside the decidua capsularis. And outside this decidua capsularis, between the decidua capsularis and parietalis, we can see the uterine cavity. Now, so in this stage, there are three cavities: amniotic cavity, then the chorionic cavity, and the uterine cavity. There are three cavities. So these cavities, now as the fetus starts growing, this decidua parietalis and capsularis, this is the capsularis and parietalis, they come close to each other and they totally fuse together. So this uterine cavity totally disappears. Even here, as the fetus grows, this amniotic cavity becomes so large that it again, this chorionic cavity also disappears. So if you can see here in this stage, only we can see a well-developed fetus, and it is totally covered by the amniotic cavity. It's filled with amnion. Okay, there are no other cavities now. The chorionic cavity has disappeared, as well as even the uterine cavity has disappeared. So this is a very important stage where all the membranes will join together. So this is called the amniochorionic membrane. Fission of the amnion and chorion. Fission of this amnion and the chorion that obliterates the chorionic cavity, and it is thin membrane that ruptures during delivery. So this amniotic cavity has enlarged, and the amnion has joined with the chorion. Okay, so this membrane, now it is called as the amniochorionic membrane, and this will rupture before the delivery of the fetus. Okay, so these are the three membranes which you can feel when if you do the PV. So you will feel the membrane. So these are nothing but the amniochorionic membranes. Now coming back to the structures which are a very important component of the placenta, these are the villi. So villi, as I said, were very important component, or you can say essential functional elements of the placenta. Okay, so they are very important structures or most essential functional elements of the placenta. These will be, as we have seen, connect the chorionic as well as the basal plate or the decidual plate, as we have seen in this pictures, previous pictures. So here you can see this is the chorionic plate which is connecting the decidual plate or the basal plate. Okay, so these are the villi. So these villi are of three types: the primary, secondary and tertiary type. Okay, in the initial stages, we have seen in these pictures, we go back again to the pictures before this, we have seen initially these are the villi. Okay, so these villi will be just having initially, it will be just from the sensitotropal blast, which will grow and form the primary villi. Okay, if you take a section now at this level, the villi, you can see only the sensitotropal blast. Later, this cytotropoblasts start invaginating inside. If you can see here, the cytotropoblasts are invaginated. Then the extra embryonic mesoderm is also invaginating inside. Okay, now it becomes secondary. Later there will be appearance of the blood vessels. Okay, then it becomes the tertiary. So these are the three stages which can be seen in case of the placenta. So if you can see here, during development, initially there will be only the sensitotropoblast as well as the cytotropoblast. Okay, at around third week, The trochlea is characterized by primary villi that consists of the cytotrophoblastic core covered by sensitiotrophoblasts. Only we will have the cytotrophoblast cells inside and sensitiotrophoblasts. Later, there will be appearance of the extra-embryonic mesoderm. Extra-embryonic mesoderm. Now, this becomes the secondary villus or the secondary villi. This is the primary villi. This is the secondary villi. Later, there will be appearance of the blood vessels within this extra-embryonic mesoderm. So, this is called as the at the end of the third week. So, there will be appearance of the blood vessels within this extra-embryonic mesoderm. Now, it is called as the tertiary or well-defined villi or definitive villi. Okay, so this is how it will look like when you see from the side. Okay, so this is the cross section of the villi. If you take a section at this level, initially, if you take a section at this level, there will be only the cytotrophoblasts inside and the sensitiotrophoblasts outside. Later, there will be appearance of the extra-embryonic mesoderm within this white colored structure. Later, there will be appearance of the blood vessels also. So, in the second stage, only we can see the extra-embryonic mesoderms, cytotrophoblasts as well as the sensitiotrophoblasts, three layers. Then with the appearance, if you take a section at this level now, so this is how the tertiary villi will look like. Okay, so there will be blood vessel deep inside, then we have the extra-embryonic mesoderm, then we have the cytotrophoblasts and sensitiotrophoblasts. These are the four layers which will form the placental barrier. The villi, the tertiary villi, the most mature villi are of divided into types. One is called as the anchoring villi and the second is the free villi. If you see, as I said before, these villi will look like a tree with the branching. Okay, so here this is the chorionic plate, this is the decidual plate and they are connecting the two sides. Okay, when they connect, this middle part, this is called the part which is connecting between the chorionic plate and the decidual plate. So this will be called the anchoring villi. Fix the chorionic vesicle to the deciduva. So these are called anchoring villi. And these will be giving branches. These are called the free villi, or they are also called the absorbing villi. So these villi will be present in the intervillar space. So this is the intervillar space here, and they are branching into the intervillar space to increase the surface area for the exchange between the fetal and maternal blood. So as they divide and branch, and the fetal blood vessels passes through them, so they increase the surface area. This whole area here, this whole area is filled with maternal blood, and the fetal blood is inside this. And here there will be exchange of gases. So as they divide and branch, so they increase the surface area. If you can see here, this is the placenta. So here this is the fetal side, this is the maternal side. So this is the decidual plate, this is the chorionic plate, and in between you can see the villi, finger-like projections. So these are the anchoring villi and they give branches in the intervillar space. This is the intervillar space filled with maternal blood. So this the fetal blood vessels will be deep inside in this villi. And here is the maternal blood. They don't come in contact with each other, but there is a barrier in between, which is made up of four layers, which is we have already studied, which is called as the placental barrier. Okay, so the exchange of will be taking place here. So you can see here the anchoring villi is the main villi, which is connecting the maternal side with the fetal side. This is the maternal side and this is the fetal side, and the free villi are the branching from the anchoring villi. So this is the anchoring villi and these are the free villi or absorbing villi, which increase the surface area for the exchange of gases. These villi again subdivided into the anchoring villi are divided into truncus cori, ramus cori, as well as the ramuli cori. So if you can see here, this is the anchoring villi, which is connecting the decidua basalis with that or decidual plate with the chorionic plate. Okay, so it is connecting the two sides, and so this is called the anchoring villi. Here will be the branching, that is the free villi. So this is the anchoring villi. So this anchoring villi is again divided into smaller branches. These are called as ramus cori. So this is the truncus cori. This is the truncus cori. So this is divided into branches. This is called as ramus cori. And these ramus cori will further divide into smaller branches. These are called as ramuli cori. finer or smaller branches. Okay, so truncus cori is the trunk of this anchoring villi. So the branches are called as ram, the main branches are called as ramus cori, and the smaller branches, these are called as the ramuli cori. Okay, and the free villi will be anchoring from here, from the anchoring villi. Okay, so the fate of the chorionic villi, we have already discussed this fate of this chorionic villi. So initially the cori, this villi will be present in all the sites around the fetus. Okay, but later they all disappear at the chorionic leaf and they will be present only at the chorionic fundosum. Okay, so the villi opposite the decidua basalis enlarge forming the chorionic fundosum. So near the decidua basalis, they enlarge to form the chorionic fundosum, fetal part of the placenta. So this becomes later the placenta. The villi opposite to the decidua capsularis atrophy. If you can see here, the decidua capsularis, they atrophy, and that part is called the chorionic leaf. Now coming to the structure of the placenta itself. We have studied the villi in detail. Now we have to together study the structure of the placenta. So by the beginning of the fourth month, the placenta has two important components. The first is the fetal portion or the fetal surface, and the second is the maternal surface. Okay, so we have seen that toward the umbilical cord, this is called as the fetal surface, and the other surface, this is called as the maternal surface. We already seen the surfaces. The fetal surface will be smooth, will be covered by the amnion. Okay, and this is the maternal surface. So near the fetal portion, this part will be called as the chorionic fundosum, and the maternal portion, this is toward the decidua basalis. The chorionic and decidual plates, we have already seen, these are the two plates. One is the chorionic plate toward the fetal side, and this is the decidual plate toward the maternal side. So borders placenta on the fetal and maternal side. These are the two boundaries for the placenta. For toward the chorionic plate will be the fetal surface, and toward the maternal surface will be the decidua decidual plate. These are the two barriers, and in between is the placenta. Whole thing is the placenta. The junctional zone is between the two plates, containing the intervillous space. So we have the villi, and in between we have the intervillous space. Okay, which is the junctional zone between the two plates. Okay, so these are the villi, and here we have the intervillous space. Now we have to know one more component. This is called the decidual septa. So decidual septa that project into the intervillous space but not reach the chorionic plate. If you can see here, there are villi which are anchoring from the maternal side, the fetal side to the maternal side. Okay, so these are the villi. From the maternal side also there are some structures which are projecting. There is nothing but the decidua which is projecting into the placenta. So these are called as the decidual septa. These are called as the decidual septa. So they are the septum which project into the intervillous space. They are projecting deep inside the intervillous space, but they don't reach the fetal side or the chorionic plate. This is the chorionic plate here. They don't reach the chorionic, but they are incomplete septums. Okay, so which are projecting into the intervillous space. So decidual septa, so these are the decidual septa that projects into the intervillous space, the intervillous space, but not reach the chorionic plate. They don't reach the chorionic plate. Okay, so the space between the two decidual septum, the space is called as cotyledon, one cotyledon. If you can see here, the space between the two septum, this is called as the one cotyledon. If you now you can see here, so these are the cotyledons, and in between there are decidual septa which are going deep inside. So if you go deep inside, there will be septums which are around the cotyledons. So the space between the two septum, this is called as one cotyledon. The cotyledon, the placenta is divided by the decidual septum into compartment. These are the functional units of the placenta. These are the cotyledons, which are nothing but the space between the two decidual septums. Okay, so these are cotyledon. They are 15 to 30, as I said before. So this is what can be seen from the maternal side. This becomes rough because of the elevations of the cotyledons and the depressions at the septums. Okay. Now coming to the circulation of the placenta. Now we have studied the whole of the placenta. We have studied the gross feature, the surfaces, the size, shape, the function, the villi, the structure of the placenta in detail. Now we have to see how exactly the placenta is helpful for circulation. Now we have seen that the intervillar space is the space where the maternal blood will be coming. So this intervillar space of the mature placenta contains almost approximately 150 ml of blood coming from 80 to 100 spiral arteries. So we have seen that the blood, so if you can see here, so now again you can see here, this is the chorionic plate, this is the decidual plate, this is one cotyledon. Now the spiral arteries are opening into this intervillar space. So this intervillar space in a mature placenta will be almost 150 ml. In the intervillar space, the maternal blood will be almost 150 ml coming from 80 to 100 spiral arteries, which exchange about 3 to 4 times per minute. So every 3 to 4, almost in a minute, there will be almost 3 to 4 times exchange of this 150 ml blood. So almost 600 ml of blood flows into the placenta in a minute. Okay, so almost 600 ml will be circulating to the placenta in a minute. But always there will be almost 150 ml which will be present in the placenta itself. And this will be exchanged almost 3 to 4 times. The fetal blood arrives to the placenta by two umbilical arteries. We have already seen there are two umbilical arteries which will be coming, bringing the deoxygenated blood. If you can see here, there are two umbilical arteries which are shown in blue color because they will be having deoxygenated blood. That branch to form the capillaries which will be passing through the villi, where exchange of gases will be taking place with the maternal blood in the intervillar space. So the maternal blood will be in the intervillar space and the fetal blood will be in the fetal capillaries. Finally, oxygenated blood returns to the fetus via the umbilical vein. If you can see this picture, this is what it is shown. So the two umbilical arteries are bringing the fetal blood, and this is going into the capillaries, and here in between there is the intervillar space, and this is filled with the maternal blood. And in between the circulation, there will be exchange of gases. Between them, there is a barrier, which is the nothing but the placental barrier. Okay, so if we take a section of this villi, this is how it is seen. So you can see here deep inside, these are the blood vessels which are there. And here there is extramural mesoderm. Then we have the cytotrophoblastic cells, and outside we have the scissurotrophoblast. So this is what it is there. And here this outside, this will be filled with this is the intervillar space filled with maternal blood. So here is the intervillar space filled with maternal blood, and the fetal blood will be deep inside these capillaries. In these capillaries, okay. So during circulation, we have seen that the maternal blood and the fetal blood are separated by the placental barrier or the placental membrane. The maternal blood in the intervillar space and the fetal blood in the capillaries don't mix. They are separated by the four layers, the scissurotrophoblast, cytotrophoblast, extramembrane mesoderm, as well as the endothelium of the blood capillaries. You have seen all these four layers here. Okay, if you take a section of the villi, you can see this is the endothelium of the blood vessels, extramembrane mesoderm, cytotrophoblast, and the scissurotrophoblast cells. Okay, so by the fourth month, these four layers become two layers with the disappearance of the second and the third layer. Which is the second layer? This is the cytotrophoblast, and the extramembrane mesoderm will disappear. Now what remains is only the scissurotrophoblast as well as the endothelium of the blood vessels. We can see later stages, the blood vessels, we can see here, they have come close to each other, and now there is only endothelium of the blood vessel and the scissurotrophoblast. The other layers have disappeared. The extramembrane mesoderm, which is not there here now, and there is no cytotrophoblast. Cytotrophoblast has disappeared. Only we have the scissurotrophoblast, which is outside, and endothelium blood vessel lining of the endothelium of the fetal red capillaries. So only two layers are there. Now this will help in better exchange of the nutrition, but at the same time the danger of substances passing through this barrier becomes much more easy, because instead of four layers, now they have become just two layers. So initially there will be four layers, but the cytotrophoblast and extra embryonic mesoderm disappears by the fourth man. Now only the cinctiotrophoblast as well as the endothelium of the blood capillaries is there. Only the cinctiotrophoblast and the endothelium of the blood capillaries is there. So there will be better exchange of gases, but the danger of substances passing through the barrier has become thinner. Now much more substances can pass through this barrier. So here you can see again the picture of the same structure shown. The villi, these are the anchoring villi, and here this is the intervillous space. The spiral artery is opening the into the blood, this intervillous space. The fetal, the maternal blood is coming here, and the fetal blood is in the capillaries within the villi. Okay, so here you can see this one. So these are the anchoring villi, and these are the free villi, which are projecting into the intervillous space. So here is the intervillous villus space filled with maternal blood, and the fetal blood is inside here. So this barrier here, initially it will be four layers. As you can see here, the barrier is formed by the cinctiotrophoblast, first one. The second is the cytotrophoblast. The third is the extraembryonic connective tissue, and the fourth is the endothelium. By the fourth month, these two will disappear. Now there is only the cinctiotrophoblast and endothelium. By the fourth month, the blood vessels have come closer to the wall, and the extraembryonic mesoderm is not there, and the cytotrophoblasts have disappeared. So now there are only two layers, cytotrophoblast as well as endothelium. So there will be better exchange of gases, but as I said, the danger of substances, much more substance passing through this barrier and damaging the fetus, will be having much more chances. Okay, so this is all about the placenta, the mature placenta, its structure as well as its size, shape, everything. Then we have studied the functions of the placenta. Then we have studied about the villi and how these villi are developed, from the primary villi, secondary villi, to tertiary villi, how they are different from each other. We have seen the different parts of the villi as well as the subdivisions of the villi and the development of the villi itself, as well as the structure of the placenta itself and the circulation within the placenta. This is all about the placenta. If you have any doubts regarding this, you can write back to me, and inshallah we will try to answer. So these are my references. Thank you very much.